everybody. This is Rochelle, and you're listening to Harv Roman, the greatest. My love on WGCO 1590 AM.
Por última vez, tenemos que hablar. Mejor que sea ya, pues mi valor me puede faltar. Por más que traté, no te pude cambiar. Tú que me entiendes bien sabrás que a ti nada te quiero ocultar. Pero tengo que ser, tengo que ser como soy. Aunque te pierda al fin, seré quien más te amó. Nadie dará lo que te doy. Por eso hoy, si voy a perderte ya, que sea por vez final. Si voy a perderte ya, es para siempre. Prefiero dejarte ir y aprender a vivir sin ti, porque si voy a perderte ya, no vuelvas. ¿Qué esperas de mí?
AM 1590 is WCGO Radio in Chicago, where Chicago goes for Club Kids Radio and Celebrity Hotline Conversations early on a Saturday morning. Starting off this Saturday's edition of Club Kids Radio Celebrity Conversations for WCGO is Gloria Estefan. Perdete. I'm going to lose you. I'm going to lose my mind. I'm losing things. That's what she was doing a few years ago. She was one of the Latina divas who our Celebrity Hotline guest looks up to and talked about in an all-new Celebrity Hotline conversation. Yes, it is Thanksgiving weekend, and there was a freestyle homecoming on Wednesday over at the Martini Club, and Rochelle had her freestyle homecoming. Yay! You know, she's relocated. She's a Chicagoan by birth, and she wound up moving to Florida to raise her family, and now she came back for Thanksgiving weekend, and we had a celebrity conversation with her. And in that conversation, we went back to 1994 and talked about words that she said to me when she was a very young teenager. So before we go to our all-new conversation with Chicago's freestyle legend, Rochelle, let us go back to 1994. That was 18 years ago.
Wow, that was fun. What would you say was the best piece of advice you've received so far in the years that you've been making music?
The best advice is what I just said now.
Oh, that was told to you by somebody else.
I'm just playing. No, the best advice was, well, like always, you know, everybody's going to tell you this. If you have a dream, to work for it and reach your goals.
I noticed every time that I've met you, from back in January through the practices here at the club to the interview right now, your mother is always in the picture. Tell me about the role that your mom plays in your career.
My mother is the best thing in my life. My mother has been there, of course, for my whole life. She's the one that really inspired me. Like I said, there were times when I just wanted to give it all up, and she was the one telling me, you know, giving me advice. And she's everywhere I go, she's there with me in rehearsals, anywhere. And she's the one that used to run with me here and there to sing here and sing there when I was three. She's the one that got me in ballet classes. I just want to thank her for everything, because I just love her.
Well, that's cool, because a lot of times there are parents that maybe aren't supportive when it comes to this business because they think that you're just not going to make it. There are other parents that might be considered backstage parents where all they're going to do is force their opinions on you. But your mother just seems to blend into the background. She's there, and you know that she's supportive, but she's not overbearing.
One thing that I really like about my mother is that she makes me have my own choices. She don't force me to do anything I don't want to do. She tells me, this is right and this is wrong. You go through where you think it's right for you. And one thing that I have a lot of friends that want to sing, but their mothers are like always putting them down and they're not supportive. And that's what I think is wrong. Mothers should start going after what their kids want and supporting their kids.
All right, now tell me, what would be the ultimate in terms of success in music for you?
The ultimate? I guess winning a Grammy. No, that's too much.
Well, no. Whitney did it. Mariah did it. Rochelle should be able to do it, too.
Well, maybe a pop record, a freestyle award.
Well, it's happening now, and it's happening all across the board. It's not only at B96. I mean, this music is getting played on the East Coast, West Coast, all coasts in between. This is going to be a strange feeling because sooner or later, you're going to be out there, not only in Chicago.
Yeah, New York, Miami. It'll be cool.
Scary, scary stuff. Before we go, Praying for an Angel, tell me what this song is about.
Well, this song is about a girl that has been hurt so many times before that she's just praying for an angel to come down and find her, not actually a lover, to find her a friend that'll be there for her and will respect her. That's usually what it is about.
Listening to the song, at sometimes it appears to be spiritual. Is there any spiritual content to the song?
Well, just the angel part.
I don't know. It sounded religion to me. So the angel is very spiritual. Anything before we go that you might want to say to the South Side in particular and Chicago in general?
First of all, I want to thank everybody. I want to thank Mike Hernandez, my manager, my producer. He's been there for me a lot, so I want to thank him. I want to thank 20 Fingers for producing my single. I want to thank SOS Records, Frank, all my friends, my family, my mother, everybody, and you. I want to thank you because, you know, you were the first one that interviewed me.
I know. That was so much fun. You know, I was looking at this, and there it is. It says 20 Fingers, produced by 20 Fingers. 20 Fingers is the same production company that did that itty bitty, teeny weeny, shriveled little song, but they've also done this song.
Yeah, Praying for a Little Angel.
You won't never do those itty bitty teeny weeny songs.
No, just like I said, Praying for an Angel is a clean song. I'm just trying to send that message out. All my songs are going to be nice and clean, you know.
Cool. So are you guys already working on a follow-up or album material maybe?
We're thinking of doing an album, but we're thinking about that now. We don't know for sure.
Cool. Anything else?
Oh, I guess that's it.
All right, cool. I do appreciate you coming by. It's dark, it's nighttime, and you could be somewhere safer. But here you are in the studios and offices of 90.5 FM. And I do want to thank you for coming by with the words and music of Rochelle.
It was a pleasure being here. Thank you.
1390 is WCGO Radio in Chicago, where Chicago goes for Club Kids Radio and Celebrity Hotline Conversations on a Saturday morning. To the Celebrity Hotline we go. Rochelle, how are you?
Hi, Harv. I'm good. How are you?
You are the Chicago legend of style who is coming back. I'm calling it a freestyle homecoming. I don't know if anybody else is calling it a freestyle homecoming, but I figure you're from here. You left here, now you're coming back here. So wouldn't that be a homecoming of sorts at the Martini Club?
Sure, of course. It is a homecoming for Thanksgiving.
Are you staying, or are you just doing a show and then going back out to Florida?
No, I'm actually staying. I'm going to be there till Sunday. I'm going to take that time, too, to spend Thanksgiving. And I haven't spent a Thanksgiving in Chicago for about 8 years, so I'm pretty excited.
For those of you who are not in the know, Rochelle is coming back Wednesday, the day before Thanksgiving, at the Club Martini. That is 3124 North Central Avenue. And I've been hounding you, and I guess I should apologize on the air for harassing and hounding and stalking you. I've been wanting to talk to you for a while now, just to kind of catch up on what you've been up to. And it just is a coincidence that you became available to talk right before this thing at the Martini Club. So maybe it was just meant to be the way it is.
I think that's what it is. I mean, it was always just a matter of time, not having the time, but it's different now. I'm making time, Harv. Don't apologize.
It's a lot different now, because the first interview we did for the Classic WCYC Radio, I want to say, and the video's on YouTube, I think you were only 14 years old at the time, so...
Oh my God, yes, I was a 14-year-old little girl chewing gum. I was chewing gum, looking around. Oh my God, yeah, I was a little teenager at that point.
I think for the original interview, because we did a couple of them back then, I think for the original interview, you were not yet using Rochelle as a stage name. And I also remember that you had a manager at the time who answered a lot of the questions that were directed towards you, but that was also the show that introduced the world to Law, so it was kind of a historic show when you think about Law and Rochelle appearing on their first interviews back in, I want to say, 1994.
Yeah, it's 1994, I believe, 93, 94.
You know, one of the interesting things about that interview is when we did a follow-up interview at the Boys and Girls Club that I used to work at, and by then, you were Rochelle, and by then Praying for an Angel came out, and one of the questions that I had asked you was about the biggest influence in your life up until that point. Do you remember what your answer was?
I don't.
You talked about your mom.
You know what, right now when you asked me that, my mom did cross my mind. I'm like, oh my God, I don't want to say my mom, and then I said something else, but... Definitely, yes. My mother, she has a lot to do with the reason why, obviously, I'm here today, and musically also.
Well, back then, when you said it was your mom, it was a refreshing thing, because you were a teenager, number one, so there aren't very many teenagers, even in this day, that if you ask them who they admire and whose footsteps they want to follow, they're going to say mom or dad. They're going to say little this or little that or tattoo this or low gene that.
I've always been really close to my mom, and I still am. You know, she's the one that never forced me to do what I do, but she encouraged me, and she did a lot. I mean, to tell you that my mom did a lot, my mom doesn't drive. She never drove. She has, like, a phobia to drive, and in order to take me to my ballet classes, singing classes, all my shows, we were on the bus. We were on the bus below zero. It didn't matter how cold it was. If I had to get to my ballet class, my mom was there.
We
struggled a lot, and we went through a whole lot, and she was always there. And a lot of parents will give up on it, but she didn't. She didn't, which is why I'm grateful.
Well, I was going to say, back then, yes, you had a manager, but if there was such a thing as a mom being a road manager, that was your mom. She was everywhere you went. And a lot of times these days, the artists don't want their parents to be backstage moms, so they don't want them anywhere near you. You were the opposite. You know, you two, you were like sisters.
Yeah, no, we were. I think up till When I was around 17, 18, of course, that's when my mom started kind of backing off and telling me, you know, that she wasn't really going to be part of it 100%. She wanted me to find my, kind of like gave me the boot. She said, find your own
way. No, she did not.
But, I mean, it turned out great.
Well, it did. How, you know, when you look at a collection of Tommy Boy records and it's Freestyle's Greatest Beats and there's only certain songs that are chosen for the compilations and your song was one of the rare Chicago songs that met that type of plateau, what is that like now? Because back then, I don't know if you realized everything that was going on with your song or if you were just going along, you know, with a Have Fun at the Riviera, but now when you think about Praying for an Angel, you know, it's considered a classic song. How does that feel for you?
It feels great. I mean, back then I was so young. I really didn't know what the meaning of things were, and I wasn't really aware of. I was just, like you said, going along with it. I was hearing the music, the songs on the radio, and I was happy with that. But, I mean, thinking about it now, I'm very proud of that. And I'm grateful that I got to participate in a project like that. And even more, that it's a song that never dies. It's a song that, till this day, like, I've had people come up to me. Not too long ago, I had a girl come up to me. She was crying. She was like, you don't know how much this song means to me, how much this is the song that I heard when I met my, you know, my husband. And I'm just like, you know, that makes me happy. It makes me happy that my song caused an impact, and to be considered a classic is, you know, loss of words.
Well, it absolutely is, because back then you were going toe-to-toe with Gillette's Itty Bitty Teeny Weeny song. You were going toe-to-toe with Rula's Lick It. There were a lot of novelty songs, and Freestyle was kind of in the middle of whether it's going to go away or not. And then your song comes out. And song with real lyrics and real instruments. Charlie did an incredible job on that tune, and I think, you know, you were responsible for the sound not disappearing as quickly as it might have, just because your song sounded so different. And then when you performed, I remember the riff. You had like 800 dancers that day.
Yeah, I did. We wanted to make it a really powerful show. We wanted to open up and just like blast everybody, like, wow. And we auditioned a lot of dancers, and I came up with like 100 dancers. It was fun days.
Well, it was fun, and your outfit would still work now.
Yeah.
tell for listeners.
I would bring 100 of them up on stage, but hey,
That was such a powerful performance. And back then, you're a teenager. I'm Mike, with all these dancers behind you at the Riviera nightclub. And to do the Riv back then, that was as high as you could go in terms of freestyle and dance music. And there's a teenager on stage, not looking nervous at all, and just controlling that crowd. And you've maintained that, because I've seen some of the shows, some of the video that's been up from what you've done recently, and you can still work the crowd.
Oh yeah, I mean, Harv, I've been singing in public on stage since the age of five. I was 5 years old when I was put on stage to sing a song, and ever since I haven't, you know, I didn't stop. So it's a lot of years of experience.
Tell us about the transformation from everything that you were doing in Latin America that people may not know about, to becoming Rochelle, who is now the legend that she is.
It was really weird, because here I was totally singing Spanish I was at an EMI Latin Records, and I'm singing, you know, Spanish pop, and I even had a totally different name, which was Rosita.
I remember.
And, you know, I slowly left that market. It was hard. I mean, I didn't leave it because I wanted to. It's just a lot of things happened. Long story. But I guess it was just meant to be. I was one day sitting at home, and I had a friend come over and said, you know what, I know a manager, a producer that's looking for talent. And I'm like, oh, here we go. You know, like, okay, now what? And they're like, yeah, you know, it's English, so I don't know if you like that kind of music. And I'm like, you know, of course. I grew up in Chicago. I love house and freestyle. And so I was excited. Like, it's a new record company, SOS Records. And I went and I auditioned, and they, you know, right off the bat, I got hired. And they were like, well, we need to change your name, because obviously we're not going to have a freestyle song, a dance song. We're not going to say Rosita, because it just doesn't match. So we're sitting there wondering, okay, so what can be my name? What's close enough? You know, what can we change it to? So the company came up with Rochelle. And it's a nice name. So I was young. I'm like, okay, yeah, Rochelle it is.
Well,
so, you know, I was started singing, and the transition was natural. I grew up listening to this, so it wasn't hard at all to start this new music. And Harv, I don't know if you know this, but I'm transitioning to other things now, and I don't know who the transition to that is going to be. I guess in the next interview I can tell you.
Well, what are some of the things and that's one of the things that people talk about when an artist who came out, you know, years ago kind of is not on the scene as much. You'd be considered a retro artist or a classic artist or a legendary artist. And a lot of times the artists don't come up with anything new. I know you did some Spanish stuff for a little while. Loca was one of my favorite songs that didn't seem to get, you know, a whole lot of play. I thought that was a fun song for you.
No, it was a really fun song. It was more like an experiment. It really didn't, it never got to anyone's hands. It was something just, look, let's hear these songs, let's do it, let's see how it sounds, and basically that was it. But that would have been really nice, but it just, for some reason, it didn't.
Well, maybe you were ahead of your time, because every so often there's a Latin music explosion, and if it's not Ricky Ricardo, it's Ricky Martin, and if it's not Ricky Martin, it's Marc Anthony. It's like every few years, every 8 or 9 years, there's a new Latin explosion, and maybe you just came in between one of those explosions, because you were bilingual, you did both lyrics in Spanish and in English, and you really should have blown up with stuff like that.
Which, that'll be great, which is what my intentions are now. I'm creating this bilingual sound. I'm doing English and Spanish. I've always looked up as a child to Gloria Estefan. I always did, because of the fact that she can blow in a Spanish song as well as in an English song. And she's one of the few. So I still look up to her. So, yeah, one of the projects that I'm working on is definitely, it's going to be a mix of both.
that it's going to be so much fun, and the fact that you're now a Floridian, just like the Estefans, you guys might bump into each other one day.
That'll be great. That would be great. But I am not a Floridian. My heart is still, I'm a Chi-Town girl.
you know where your heart is? Where were your feet maybe a week and a half ago?
My what? I'm sorry?
So where were your feet maybe a week and a half or so ago? Talking about...
Killer cut. Yep, she said she liked it and it never went into anybody's hands. It's kind of sort of in my hands. I'm Harv Roman. That's Rochelle. That wasn't, it's entitled Loca. Before that, we heard Nene. We also heard Praying for an Angel. And at the top of the hour, we play Gloria Estefan music, Perdete, only because Rochelle talks about in the conversation of the influence and admiration that she has for Gloria Estefan. So I said, why not start off this edition of WCGO's Celebrity Conversations with some Gloria Estefan. And I have to apologize. A minute ago, I did some really sloppy board work as I was trying to get all these words and music together. And I'll probably redo this, but I'm going to continue right now because we got about a half hour to go in this particular edition of WCGO Club Kids Radio Celebrity Conversations. Today, our Celebrity Hotline Conversation with Rochelle. And we started it off with about 5 minutes worth of an interview that we did in 1994 when she was a teenager. And it's kind of interesting when you flash forward to 2012, the words that she used, which were pretty much similar when she talked about the admiration that she has for her mom. Wow, about a half hour to go. More Rochelle, more Harv, and more of this stuff. Is this Denzel? No, it's the Be Great One.
My name is Kim. I will deliver your mail.
My name is Timothy, and I'll be your son's math teacher.
My name is Darnell. I will be patrolling your neighborhood.
My name is Matt. I'll be managing your retirement portfolio.
My name is Maria. I will check your vital signs.
I will be fixing your pipes.
I will be teaching you a new software program.
I will be landing your flight safely.
I will be assessing your taxes.
I will be your congresswoman.
I will be the chairman of the board.
I will be an influence on our community.
I will be your neighbor.
I will be engineering the next great technology.
I will be great.
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 Wake up, dancing.
That's me right here, 1590 AM, WCGO Radio, where Chicago goes for Celebrity Hotline Conversations early on a Saturday morning. And our conversation this Saturday morning is with our Chicago freestyle legend, Rochelle, who's in town for Thanksgiving Day weekend over at the Martini Club. Oh, if you missed it, you missed it. And I was there. I was hosting the event. Kenny Jam and Jason, the legend of the Hot Mix 5, and the original program director of WCYC Radio. How many of you knew that? Which was the original home of Club Kids Radio, which is something that Kenny put together starting back in like 78 or 79. Did you know? And Rochelle with her freestyle homecoming was so cool. Who's out there? Who's clickety-clicked on us? Who has checked in on the Facebook with us? Luz and Jessica and Carol and Cora, Juana, Christina, another Christina, Angelo, Julia, Rudy, Johnny, Myrna, Martha, Madeline, Libby, Teresa, all Club Kids, all past Club Kids, Nadine, Judy and Gabriel, that's a mother-son swim team, tag team thing, Nathalie, Maria, Nikki, and Delilah have all checked in via the Facebook as they're listening to what we're doing right here at 1590 AM, and we appreciate the fact that you're listening to this Celebrity Hotline Conversation, especially because, you know, we're doing it on Thanksgiving weekend, which you may still be having those stretchy pants issues or recovering perhaps from Black Friday. Let us continue now. This is something that you may not have heard before. Another one of those songs that kind of was a secret. This one is a freestyle song entitled Freestyle. It's Rochelle, everybody.
It makes me sad because I grew up, I mean, we all did. We grew up around that neighborhood, and to see something that was there for so many years, and now you look and it's empty, it's really heartbreaking. So, but like I said, Margie's candy,
they can't go anywhere.
That, no one touches that, I will be out of depression.
They're not allowed.
Margie's candies must stay.
They're not allowed to sell. They're not allowed to go away. They're not allowed to change their recipes. Because you're right, you could go in there now and you still see the old school boots and the old school chair, and even the way they churn out their ice cream seems to be old fashioned.
I love it. That place is wonderful. It's a classic.
Hey, I want to talk a little bit about the way you came up singing. When you listen to the way that you sing, there's a difference between you and a lot of the other artists that are out there. And when I think about your particular style, so to speak, it seems like you had a background in churches or choirs or something like that. Would I be wrong?
Not necessarily. Not growing up in it, but I can say for a little bit, I did do a couple of songs, Christian songs. Mm. Not really for myself. I would go to church and sing at church. Just maybe for about a year. And I enjoyed it. It was great.
Well, I say that because the way you sing sounds so polished. And, you know, back then and even now, you know, just about anybody can go into a studio and come out with a record. And when it's time to sing live, people struggle. When you sing live, you always did a thing where you might start off a cappella or end a cappella, or whoever was running the concert tape would turn it down a little bit so then you could do something that actually sounded live. Not a lot of people did that then, and really not too many people do that now.
Yeah, it's ironic. We were just talking about that yesterday when on our way home from the studio, we were talking and how it's they can hear the song and on the radio and just when I sing, they're amazed that it's I can sing exactly like I recorded it. Just yesterday, Harv, we were talking about this. I guess that's a blessing. It's a blessing because it's true what you're saying. Not to downfall, you know, not to speak down to any other artist, but not a lot of people can do it live.
And I like the idea.
Not the same.
Well, no, and you know, there are very few. George, your buddy George Lamond is one of them, where you could just tell that there's natural talent. You could just tell.
Yeah, he just blows on that microphone. Yeah, he's one of the ones that, just like he can sing to you in front of your face on a record, it's the same thing on stage.
You know, it's interesting.
But like you said, there is a few. Not a couple of weeks ago, I had my producer come to the house with a piano, and he told me, "Can you sing a little piece of this song?" And I'm not going to say the artist, but he's like, "Can you sing a little piece of the song?" So he started playing the piano, and I was singing it. And that song in particular, it goes really high, and I hit the notes like nothing. And he stopped playing and looked at me, and he was like, "In all of my years playing, I've never heard anyone hit these notes." He's like, "Not even the artist. Till this day, the artist cannot hit her own notes." And you just hit them like it was nothing. So it's a blessing.
No, that's not a surprise. I remember doing some work with Georgie Porgy once upon a time. I think you know Georgie. And he would audition people at Music Plant, and he would say, "If you could sing Happy Birthday," and that's what he would have them sing. He wouldn't have them do scales. He wouldn't have them do some crazy songs. Whitney Houston, he'd make them sing Happy Birthday. And he says, "If they can sing Happy Birthday, they're pretty good." Apparently, Happy Birthday is not an easy song to sing.
I don't know. Never heard of that one, but if it works.
Yeah, well, it worked for him. Talk about your career, because, you know, it's interesting now because, obviously, you're no longer a teenager. You're still out performing. It almost seemed for a little while that you were not going to do the performing anymore, that you had become, you know, a mom, and you had become...
I let it all go. I did. I was really, how can I say, discouraged. I was really sad by the way I've met so many great people, but yet I've met a lot of people that don't have good intentions. So, you know, a lot of people, basically, I'm just going to say it like it is, a lot of people just wasted my time, and I was sad. I was discouraged, and I hung it up. I hung up the microphone. I said, "I'm not going to do it anymore." So I decided to say, "You know what? That's it. It was meant to be. Well, what can I do? I'll live my, you know, if my kids want to sing, if I will help them. But I don't want to do it anymore." So I did. I left it. But if you really love music and it lives in you, it's really hard to continue every day of your life and not do what you love to do. So I couldn't let it go. And here I am again. Here I am again. As much as I tried, I did try to, you know, live the normal life. And I'm not saying I don't do it now, because I am a mother and I have a family, but I can't let the music go. I just can't. I mean, I think I'm going to be, if I don't make if I don't make music, you'll see me, I'll probably be singing karaoke somewhere when I get old. And
do you think
that?
Well, so do you think
I'll still be singing. I've come to the conclusion that I cannot let it go. Well,
about social media these days with your Facebook and before that the MySpace and the Twitter and everything else, you could vent like you do sometimes, and then you've got people that really have no idea who you are. They haven't met you, they don't know you, but they know that they grew up on your music, that your song had such an impact on them. So there have been times where I've seen you vent and then you get shooken up by some of your fans, and all of a sudden you get emotional based on those types of comments.
Yes, I do. I mean, that's one of those. Those social, you know, sites, they are good. I mean, especially from my page, a lot of people, you know, especially family members, they go, you know, you're ridiculous. Why do you have that page and you share it, you know, your family, and you have everything mixed together with your fans, and why do you say this and that? And I really don't care. Like, I don't care. I want to mix everything together because the people that look up to me and look up to my songs, I want to make them part of my life. And when I'm having a bad day, like everybody does, because we all do,
right?
You know, I don't say everything, but I'll vent, yes, and I'll say something, and they make me feel better. They make me feel better, so it's great.
Well, you're performing on Wednesday. I'm very lucky. I get to introduce you on that night. And now that you're a classic artist, it's going to be interesting because you end up on stage.
Forward to that, Harv.
I'm sorry?
I'm looking forward to that. I haven't seen you in a long time.
It's been, wow, I want to say you were a kid. I don't want to call you a kid, but back then you pretty much were a kid. And now you're an adult.
Baby, I'm a teenager now. I was a baby back then.
Yeah, that's right. You started when you were 6 years old. I remember you and Brooke Shields. And what I would love to see, and I'd like to see a reaction to it, maybe you could just talk about it now. When you perform, you've got one of those, you know, songs where people know every lyric. And so here you are on stage, you're performing, and there's 900 people, you know, singing along with you. What's that like?
It's great. It's great. I can't even describe it. It's just great. I love the feedback, the love I get from everybody that comes out to my shows. And I'm the type of person that when I'm done singing, I don't hide back in backstage. After I'm done singing, I'm out there and I'm signing autographs and taking pictures, and I just love. I love the way people accept me, and it's great. It's a great feeling. I enjoy it. I love doing it, and I'm going to continue to do it.
No, back in the WCYC days when you first started, could you fast forward all these years and think that in 2012, and remember our first conversation was in 1994, that was, wow, 18 years ago. Had you visions of, you know, 5, 10, 15 years down the road in terms of this still happening for you? Or do you just think it was going to be one of those things, well, I'll do it and then I'll move on with life?
No, definitely not. I've never thought about it in that way. I actually thought that I would done so much more. And I really do regret not doing so much more, but it's never too late. It's not one of those things where I'm like, even as a child, when I was younger, I never thought of just doing this for a little while. To me, it's always been long term.
Well, that's an interesting answer. So you had visions of, you know, Grammys in your head and...
Definitely. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And then when things don't work out, it soured you, but not enough to just completely leave.
Exactly. It's the love of music. It just keeps me alive, basically.
Wow. So now, what next for Osha? What can we expect come Wednesday at Club Martini? You're not a little girl anymore. You could actually get into this place. You know, years ago, you couldn't even get in to perform.
Years ago, I couldn't. I mean, I'm looking forward to it. I'm going to have fun. I want to go and I want to celebrate. I want to enjoy with everybody. I'm going to be singing a few songs, but I'm also going to sing a song that a very talented person made for me, made a really nice beat. It's hot. It's awesome. And I wrote to it. I wrote some lyrics, and it turned out to be wonderful. So I'm going to be performing that. I can't wait for that.
You know, talking to you throughout all this time, you seem so humble and so real and so approachable. Do you ever sit back and say, wow, I had this role in this genre of music and I'm more than just a footnote? You were an important person in this.
No, I just see myself as everyone else. I really never thought about it like that.
Well, you start thinking about it because you get your little Facebook hits and you get your YouTube hits. When it goes into the thousands and thousands of thousands, you're one of those acts that was very influential back then, and there are so many that wanted to follow in your footsteps, and I'm so glad that you're back and performing and you're working on something new, which will...
Yes, Harvey, you'll see a lot more of me. You're going to get sick of me, actually.
That will never happen.
You'll see a lot more.
So what's it like being a mom now? You're a mom and you're performing and you're like washing clothes and working and taking...
Yes, I'm a super woman, and there is no one out there that can say I'm not. I am super woman. I have four children. Yes, I have four children. I wanted it that way. I always said I wanted four children, and that's what I got. I have two boys and two girls.
So you got a good sister.
They're wonderful. They're my life. I enjoy being a mom. I also work, and I do music, and I do everything at home. So, Harv, yes, I am 100% busy all day, every day of my life.
Well,
I love it.
Your mother laid some real nice footsteps for you to follow, and it's good to see you doing so well. And we're proud of you, and you've given Chicago such a great name, and you went national, and it is so cool to talk to you again. It had been so long, but we've been in contact with each other. We just hadn't had a radio conversation. I'm glad that we were
able to. We've talked, but not on the radio.
Keep holding on.
So you're coming back to Chicago, and I keep calling it a freestyle homecoming because you know what's going to happen, Rochelle, before we go. You're going to have people that knew you in high school, people that knew you when you were 14 years old, people that knew you when you graduated, people that knew you when you became, you know, a young mom, and here you are coming back even younger to perform. Is that pressure? Is it going to be one of those things where you're just going to look at it as a big family reunion?
I say it's like a big family reunion.
That is so cool to hear. This I look
people there that I haven't seen in years, so.
And they're going to tell you that you haven't changed, that you're still the same. You still, you know, you look great, you sound good, and, you know, your career, and we talked about this once online, and we started comparing notes with some of the other artists out there. You know, if Mick Jagger can still do what he's doing at the age of 62, and if you look at...
Oh, yeah.
And you look at some...
It doesn't, I mean, age doesn't really matter anymore. You know, people can still do it. If you have the talent, you can still do it.
So. Hey, here's something I didn't even think about asking you, but I should ask you now because you've kind of grown up, you know, listening to all kinds of music, and now your kids are listening to music by people like Lady Gaga. When you think about dance music these days, what kind of direction do you think is going in, and how would you compare Lady Gaga with some of the, you know, like the Madonnas from back then?
Lady Gaga, to me, is she's great. She's original. I wouldn't compare her to Madonna only because she, how can I say this? Madonna is great, but Lady Gaga has her own style, and the voices are totally different.
True.
I mean, Lady Gaga has a great voice, and she has her own style. I think dance music now is... I like what I'm hearing. I love the fact that we have Chris Brown, Rihanna, we have Neo, we have Enrique Iglesias, all these people are trying to do dance music now, and we're getting away from the regular pop music. So I love it. I love to hear it when, you know, when I turn the radio on and I see that Neo came up with a new song, or and David Guetta. I love it. I'm really enjoying.
That's what you have to do Wednesday. You have to come up with your own Gangnam Style thing on stage.
Yeah, I love it. I love dance music. I love house. It's my favorite. So imagine, I'm enjoying myself. Every time I hear these songs on the radio, on YouTube, I love it.
You know, here's another interesting comment. I was talking earlier, just today, you know, we weren't taping an interview. We're just keeping in contact with Tony Ortiz of from TKA. He has a daughter now by the name of Brooke Penning, and she's got a killer cutout. And he's got two other kids that are performers, but Brooke Penning seems to be the one that's going to blow up. And it's interesting because you've got Tony from TKA and his daughter Brooke, and now she's doing a lot of the things that he tried to do back then. When it comes to your own kids, you've got a nice, you know, set of two boys and two girls. At first, did they look at you as mom, the performer, or now when they see that you're going to be gone for a couple days, coming to Chicago to perform? What is it like in terms of the family, and Rochelle's the performer as opposed to Rochelle the mom, and are your kids into what you do?
My kids are very into it. They love music. They were naturally born with it. Especially my daughters. My 10-year-old daughter has a beautiful voice, and she really wants to sing. She wants to sing. She wants to be involved. She's always involved in it. When I'm singing, when I'm writing, she's right there. She's right there looking at everything I'm doing. My 5-year-old daughter, she's also a singer, natural born. I'm telling you, these girls can really sing. So I know for a fact that in the future they will be pursuing this career. I'm not going to push them to do it because I'm a believer that you can't push anyone to do something. If you're naturally born and it's what you want to do, you know, so be it. And I'll be there for them 100%.
Well, that's the natural follow-up
question. He loves music, too. I mean, even though he doesn't like to sing in front of people, he gets really, he just doesn't like it. But he loves music. And my little 2-year-old, naturally, natural born, he sings. I'm going to do a Jackson 4.
That is hilarious. Well, considering that your career had its peaks and valleys and its challenges, in a way, it's almost surprising that you would say, you know what, if my babies want to do this, I'm going to support them, I'm going to let them, because you have every reason to say, you know what, I've been through it all, and I don't want you to go through what I went through.
Right. I've been through a lot, and a lot of people talk about this business, how, yeah, you can fall into alcohol, you can fall into drugs, you can do this, you can do that, but it's not true. And the reason I say that I will support them 100% is because not everyone, yes, I've been through a lot, but I also know the things that I had, that I need to teach them in order not to fall into those situations, and I also know what to look out for, what people to be aware of, and that's when I would be in there 100%. You know, I would help them make sure that they don't make the wrong step. Obviously, I can't say, you know what, I don't want my child to be in this business, because it hasn't been bad at all for me, and if it would have been bad, I wouldn't be doing it right now.
You know, it's interesting that we talk about, and now we're getting all social and talking about, you know, tear-jerking stuff, but think about some of the people that you came up with, some of the groups that you've performed with, and not all of them managed to survive those years. Not all of them are still with us. Some of them, you know, you've got people who are in jail, you got people who are no longer living. And you've managed to do really well on stage, off stage, on the air, off the air. How is it that you managed to do things and survive where so many others were just eaten up and spit out by the business?
I say a lot has to do with a lot has to do with God. I think a protection. If you always keep the faith, and he's even though, you know how they say that God doesn't support, we're getting religious now.
Well, we're not going to have time to get religious right now, because it's peeking into the top of the hour right here at WCGO with 1590 AM. Rochelle, Chicago's freestyle legend, who had her freestyle homecoming this week at the Martini Club. If you missed it, well, there's probably video on YouTube. In the back of your head right now is Praying for an Angel. We also listened to two versions of Holding On to Love, the English and the Spanish version. And then freestyle started off this particular segment of Words and Music, Celebrity Conversations, Club Kids Radio, however you want to call it. That's what it is. Wow, my thanks to Rochelle for that Celebrity Hotline conversation. We have another segment or two that we'll have to do during another edition of WCGO Celebrity Conversations, because look at the time. We got to fly. Thanks again. Talk to you soon. Later.